great authors afternoon gathering. It happens to be the 51st and a very special one because today we are talking about a book which is about an ethos which goes, you know, it's very local. It's about Bengalis and I'm sure that the conversation is going to be extremely interesting. To say briefly about the author, Sudeep Chakravarti, he has had an extensive career and great contributions in the world of journalism and editorial experience in Media Today, Hindustan Times, and he's actually sort of spearheaded certain programs in line of editorial marketing, which are still you know, highly successful in these organizations. Beyond that, of course, he's a great author of narrative nonfiction books. And today, in conversation with him, we have our dear filmmaker and theater director, Suman Mukhopadhyay, who is one of the best known film directors that I have known. And lovely to have you both, gentlemen. Please take your seats. And let's look forward to a lovely conversation.
Thank you, Shamrat. Thank you, Shambhi. Good afternoon, friends. We've come this afternoon to listen to this conversation, but rather than a conversation, we want to hear more from the author. I'm just the agent provocator, would like to kind of poke to bring more deeper nuances. I will predominantly talk about the book Bengalis, which is his last book, but his achievement in the literary field is quite big. The spectrum is quite large, in fact. To start, you know, to begin before we ask him to speak about his books and about his literary career, I just want to say an anecdote. Just the day when Sandeep and his team was communicating with me, I'm in Bombay, so I told Sandeep, I have to come from Bombay. So no problem, come. So they invited me. So, and Sandeep told me, the first time somebody's coming from out of the town to have the conversation. So, and the anecdote is that, the day this has been confirmed, I went to watch a film called The Monsoon Shootout. It's a very special screening. And we were sitting in the lobby, and there's a young girl, like 22 or 23, was reading a book in the corner. So I was quite curious that in this kind of screening, volume screening, who will come and read a book before the screening. So I was quite curious, she's a young girl. Then suddenly I saw the book in her hand is The Red Sun. And immediately, you know what happened then, I was quite astonished to the fact that, you know, today, I was supposed to have a conversation with Sudeep in a couple of days, and then just watching this girl in a Bollywood screening, Monsoon Shootout, is watching Red Sun. So immediately, and then my one common friend came and introduced her. He's a girl from, not a Bengali, he's a girl from Chandigarh, a Punjabi girl reading Red Sun. It's quite a, you know, strange combination. And when we introduced, I told her that, look, I'm going to meet the author. She was so elated and excited. She almost jumped out of the seat. Oh, I'm meeting Sudeep Chakravarti, you know, just tell her that I'm a great fan. So, you know, so I'm trying to give that feeling that you are a very popular writer. And young girls like 22, 23 are kind of going gaga on your book and like Red Sun, which is a very difficult subject in a way. It's on the Maoist, it's on the Naxalbari movement. Okay, come back to the book which we talked, the Bengalis. We both are Bengalis. And then I would first want to ask you that there are many books on Bengalis. The history, the geography, the evolution, the Bengalis, especially some books recently been published like Bangal Nama by Professor Tapan Choudhury, Raj Choudhury, or Pranab Bardhan, and of course the classical ones like the autobiography of an unknown Indian by Nirasi Choudhury, which you mentioned in the book also. So I want to know that why you want to revisit this history of the Bengalis again in 2017, What actually made you this attempt, or provoked you, or inspired you to bring back this the evolution of Bengalis, or restating the history of Bengalis? That was my first.
All right. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, is this mic working? Can you hear me?
Yeah,
is this on?
The mic is yes, it is.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, or actually, as a Bengali or Bangali, I'm supposed to project by default. So and that's one of our sort of USPs, if you will. I think we are on now. Are we on?
Can you explain it?
All right.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. But before I get there, Suman, I want to sort of address the ladies. We actually have two ladies from Chandigarh here. And though it's sort of not quite Punjab, it's sort of shared status between Punjab and Haryana, I must sort of defend the realm, if you will, by stating that, you know, at the time when Rajbihari Bose was throwing bombs around Delhi and elsewhere, there was a party called the Gadar Party as well, which had strong roots in Punjab. So I think, strange as it might seem, the revolutionary roots do go back to Punjab for several decades. And as you would know very well, and this is one of his tricks to provoke the conversation, because he's doing his job well, is that during the so-called Naxal movement, or the Naxalwari movement, it's actually spread rapidly westward from Naxalwari and went to Punjab very, very quickly. More quickly than the government of India thought possible at the time. And even today, though Punjab would be greatly loath to admit it, there is a strong undercurrent of what would be called revolutionary thought, if not necessarily revolutionary action, that continues in the Pind, which is the heartland or the soul of Punjab in many, many ways. So I've taken care of you ladies. And now I can sort of, I think I have complete freedom to now sort of go ahead and tell you about how wonderful the Bengalis are. That's about the only concession I'm going to make this evening. But seriously, you're welcome. We can be generous from time to time. We can acknowledge other cultures from time to time as well. I'm just kidding. But Suman, thank you for asking that. I think possibly the difference is that it's a book in English. Banganama has been translated as well into English. Quite recently, as it happens. But I think it has been written from these are all fine books, the stories about Bengal and the Bengalis. And I would even go as far back as The History of Bengal, which was co-edited by Sir Jodhunath Sarkar and Ramachandra Mojumdar. I mean, it wasn't really a biography of the Bengali, but that, in a way, in the modern era, my apologies, because we have a celebrated historian here. To my mind, it was one of the earliest instances of trying to come to terms with the root of the Bengalis, who we are, where we came from, and the Bengali story, as it were. And then, of course, it evolved over several decades. So I don't claim exclusiveness in that genre, if you will, but certainly it is the one book that has been thought in English for a not Bengali audience. Ladies and gentlemen, I hate the word non-Bengali as a card-carrying, practicing Bengali. I think it's one of the most arrogant words that we ever have for, that we've ever coined for anybody else other than us. No other language in the world, to my knowledge, has a word called non-something. Even, you know, there are representatives of very, very chauvinistic cultures in the room at present, or with great cultures, but they have words for foreigner. But not, you know, Obangali translated into non-Bengali, to me, is a great, great arrogance. So this was thought also in the book. I mean, I was looking at it from the perspective of who people I call not Bengali. Also, many of these tellings have not included what I call the rest of what I like to call Bangla sphere. I was looking for a sort of an inclusive phrase or a word that would bring all the Bengalis, wherever they may be, apnara jekhanei thaken or amra jekhanei thaki, in the world, into a sort of a composite, if you will, even though we are very, very distinct in our own ways, culturally, linguistically, in terms of religion and background, all sorts of things, ethnic mixes, because we are a people, we're not a race, after all. So it was very important for me to conceptualize this book in terms of the Bengali in West Bengal, the Bengali in Kachar in Assam, the Bengali in areas of Assam that are not in Kachar, the Bengalis who, for reasons of history and migration, are today the majority community in Tripura, the Bengalis who, the two-thirds of the world's Bengalis live in Bangladesh, we often forget that. There are Probashi Bengalis, or the non-resident Bengali, not just in Toronto or New York or anywhere that you care to name it, they're all across the subcontinent. So I wanted to sort of string our histories, like sort of cumulative collective histories together, write a story about the people that we are, where we came from, and who we evolved into, and where we are now, and our place in the world, and to paraphrase Tagore or Rabindranath Tagore, at home in the world as well. And so I looked at the book from that point of view. And I think whether in English or Bengali, that telling has not been done yet. And I'm possibly fortunate that I had the opportunity to write the book. It is not a perfect book by any stretch of imagination, and I'm saying it myself. Everything can be a lot better. Everything can always be a lot better. And as a Bengali, I can hardly claim perfection, because there are so many Bengalis here who will jump down my throat if I were able to claim perfection. I'll keep it for the not Bengalis. So, but I mean well, of course. So, it was a grand ride, and I think it was a time to tell the story in that inclusive sense, because we're really not just in Bengal or in the subcontinent, we're in many places. And I think that we've also evolved as a people to be able to absorb a telling about ourselves and to share ourselves with the world at large. I think we've come to a state of maturity, perhaps, that we can talk about ourselves freely, that we're not constrained by even criticisms directed at ourselves. We can talk about how wonderful we are, how educated, how culturally enhanced and advanced we are. We can also look at ourselves in a critical way. One of the reasons I'm still alive, and the book has been in on the shop shelves for about a month and a half now, and I've been to Bangladesh. I was at the Dhaka Literature Festival a few weeks ago. I was treated very well and with great respect, and I came away alive. And I'm in Kolkata in front of you. I continue to be alive. So I think that itself is a sign of how my own community, if you will, let alone people who are not Bengali, have sort of accepted at least my effort to tell our story, even though it's through my own eyes and my own upbringing and my own experiences. It is a sort of a personal telling of what I think the Bengalis are, where I've tried to confront my own Bangaliana, if you will, in a saturated way, and then try and disseminate that feeling and that experience and that hold of history or politics or in any case, my understanding of it, to the world at large, including fellow Bengalis. So I think it was an opportune moment in many, many ways. And if you, those of you who read the book, and I hope all of you do, that it was also important to address many, many instances in our history, the experiences of partition, which are usually, when it comes to India, you always look to the north and the west. The Bengali partition, or the partition of Bengal, not just once, but twice over, 1905, and we came back together in 1911, and then the spark for 1947 was lit in Calcutta in 1946. We tend to forget that. So this book gave me the opportunity to address these thorny issues in our past, in our histories, our coming of age, if you will. I think we truly, in a way, come of age. Even our Renaissance was not quite coming of age. You were still sort of finding baby feet, I think, at that time. And so I think it's just timed rather well. It's all come together. Our history, our politics, our society, our sense of self, our sense of belonging, our sense of questioning, that our innate curiosity is now applied to ourselves in increasingly more critical ways. And my friend Suman, if you watch his movies, you will not need to explain that to you at all, because all his work is a questioning work. All his work, and I think I think we should be justifiably proud of that place in our time, in our history that we've come to as a people, where we can talk about ourselves in this way. And I'm so very, very happy and honored to be able to contribute my little bit into that stream of awareness, a discussion, into that stream of adda, which I hope we will have today.
So that's the one kind of a small projection from our ancestors. But now, going back to another perspective of yours, that you use the word not Bengali, or whatever it's not, like that's a fantastic, this kind of the politically correctness, or it is of course the arrogance of calling me non. But I also have another category in mind called Bengalis who are not living in Kolkata or not living in West Bengal. So you kind of fall in that category.
Well.
Right? So my question would be that as a writer, as an author, does this category, does this position gives you a special alienation from the culture, which gives you this perspective to look at things in a more, from a vantage point, which can give you more criticality or more kind of not in the romantic passion of being the Bengali, staying in Kolkata, I'm a Bengali, but mixing with other cultures, as you always say in the meeting before, that I love the mix. So mixing with other cultures, staying with other cultures, staying with not Bengali people, can get the distance, that bring the distance, that intellectual, vantage point, where you can look the entire the culture, our evolution, our movement in the history from a very different perspective. That's a special position you have gained, would you say that? Or it would have been different?
No, I think it, thank you in a way for saying that, but I think I agree and disagree. I mean, after all, more than 100 years ago, you did have right here in Kolkata an absolutely fabulous set of satire called Hutum Pachar
Naksha.
I mean, we mustn't forget that. I mean, this was satire at the Bengali Babu, the Bhadraluk, the pretensions of the Bengali society in the late 19th century. And right here, Kolkata, Boshe only Likhesilen and only Bechio Chilen. And he survived and he was celebrated. And so we have a long tradition of self-critique.
Is Kalipurushan machine,
exactly.
Also if you get Torilokonath Mukhopadhyay, like,
but even otherwise, I mean, if you take it, so I think I may not have had much of a difference in terms of approach were I to be still living in Kolkata. I mean, I do have family here, but I've lived and traveled outside Kolkata for most of my adult life. But as you, I hope I'm trying to project enough passion into my conversation with you. I mean, I'm very, very Bengali. There's no doubt in my mind about that. I'm possibly more attuned to other cultures. That does not for a moment mean that those Bengalis who remain in Bengal or rooted into Bangla sphere are not. They're deeply attuned to other cultures. And it is there in many ways in every waking moment. So I think, personally speaking, I would have, and it's also a personal thing, Suman, that whether you're in Kolkata or away, or Pashchim Bengal or away, it is who you are. I mean, there is very fine, clinical, self-critical work, and when I say self-critical, I don't mean self-flagellating, I mean self-critical, there's a difference. Work happening in Kolkata as we speak, and has happened for many, many years. So in Bangla, in English, in Hindi, which is a Kolkata language that is not always counted as a Kolkata language. Gujarati, to a great extent, has become a Kolkata language. For instance, Bangal is a great Kolkata accent, or a lingua franca, if you will. So, I mean, these are the communications and approaches in these languages continue. So I don't think that I would like to claim that distance made me clinical, or distance made me more foolish to, if you will, to take on this great, this great community that we have, and be actually foolhardy enough to presume to write what I hope is a exploratory and a somewhat definitive look at, incomplete but definitive look at who and what the Bengalis are and where we might be today. So an immersion in Bangaliana can happen to my mind whether I live in Bangladesh or not, and here I'm using Bangladesh in a very sort of holistic way, or I'm away from Bangladesh, if you will. I live in Goa, and that is quite removed from Bangladesh, but I am body and soul Bangali.
The question is not doubting
your Bangaliana. I'm trying to throw that back at you as well.
And, I also moved out from Kolkata very recently. But I will come to the recent history of Bengal. That is one major question I have for you. But before that, because if you see the people who attempted to write about Bengalis, actually, if you don't forget about the 19th century Bengal, about, you know, like if you say, you mentioned Kali Prasanna Shingo, like who was Kutum, and then Trilokonath Mukhopadhyay, another name, or even Sukumar Rai, who was evenly critical about Bengalis, you know, in his entire thing. He was his humor was like really scathing in that way. But if you see the people who've written about Bengalis, they mostly stayed out of Bengal, who tried to, like Nirosh, Pranab Bardhan, or Tapun Rai Chaudhuri. They're all Amartya Sen, who wrote about the argumentative Indian. Prishtukundan, Bangal Nama, they're all people who are in Oxford or in England or in AWS or outside Bengal. So I think that this sense of alienation, this sense of distance of not staying within the Bengali community, gave that, you know, this craving for write about Bengalis. I think so. But if you see from Bengal, who has written about Bengalis? Shulil Gangwardhan. That's the only person. But I will say that maybe somebody differ with that. Shulila is very much too much into the Bengali romanticism instead of seeing it the story from a much critical. So I think that Shunil Ganguly's writing about Bengal is more about his emotional contact. But when I'm reading them, Bangal Nama or this text, they're much more critical, humoring about themselves. I think this attitude or this position of an intellectual position comes from this distance from Bengalis. That was my point.
No, Suman, I got your point, and I was actually trying to make all you Bengalis in Kolkata feel good about yourselves. So I thought I should defend the turf before I say, yes, Suman, you're absolutely right. And I'm the sensible Bengali who took on the Bengali mantle or the mantle for Bengalis by being away from Bengal. So I'm the clever Bengali who's on an 11 o'clock flight in the morning. And you have just that much time to come after me, if you wish, but again, I so maybe we are the sensible Bengalis. Amartya Babu, Oxford, Harvard, Shantiniketan, he visits Shantiniketan to visit his mother, and then quickly goes away and writes another book out of England. So you have a point there.
The Pranab Bardhan is writing of Berkeley, no, that's what I'm saying.
Absolutely. Yeah. But yes, in a way, but maybe it gives a time for reflection. Because maybe it gave me an opportunity to. You're right, of course.
We just argumentative
Bengali, and an adda like this without arguments is just not Bengali enough. So I just created the argument for the sake of it, which is also very Bengali. Yes, you're right in a way that I think because it gave me the distance to actually sit down and retrospect or introspect and come to terms with Bengal, Bengaliness, my own little humble minuscule place in it. And also, I think I was able to sort of concentrate it in a way, not necessarily in a vacuum, but almost like in a monastery, that I was able to create a little distance, like you're right. And I didn't feel the great urge to write the book sitting in Bengal, for instance. I thought I could write it anywhere. But yes, some distance does give you perspective, because you are physically away, and by definition it would. Any culture away from the home turf, it would automatically imbue a little distance from it. It just happens that way.
Yeah, it's so, like when Edward Said is writing about Orientalism.
Yes.
He's writing it from New York. And that's what I'm saying, that it gives some perspective. Okay, now we get out of this thing and coming up to another perspective. Could you elaborate on your term, Bangla sphere? What do you mean by that?
Well, I hope that it includes the entire world. We certainly like to think so. But I was actually searching for a phrase that ties in Bengalis wherever they may be. And the thing is, I also wanted to ensure that we acknowledge that there are Bengalis outside West Bengal. As I said a little earlier, Assam, Tripura, Bangladesh. I mean, I've actually met people in Kolkata, upstanding Bengali gentlemen, intellectual, and Bengali gentlewomen, Bhadramohila, who, when they heard that I was going to Bangladesh and I was planning to write about Bangladesh in the Bengalis, they asked me, why? Why not? And I said, well, you know, cannot. Bangladesh, so I just sort of took it back a bit. Bangladesh literally means the land of Bengalis, so on and so forth. And you know, there are Prabhasi Bengalis or Prabhasi Bengalis in Allahabad, in Lucknow, in Delhi, in Jabalpur, in Ranchi, in Patna. Even for the longest times, from the time that many of these provinces were part of the Greater Bengal province, and Bengal was a spearhead of professionalism and intellect, and we went out to many places in India. From that time, we've had Prabhasi Bengalis. And I wanted to, and of course, North America, Europe, Far East, and increasingly because of the labor migrations in Southeast Asia, in West Asia, there are Bengalis, possibly except Antarctica, in a scientific expedition on the North Pole. Bengalis are really living and working and loving everywhere in the world. So I was looking for a composite term that would draw in where we could inclusively talk about the Bengalis. And hemisphere didn't work, so I thought of Bangladesh. I'm quite proud of it, actually. But I hope you ladies and gentlemen like it as well. And I'm happy to say that a lot of people are writing in to me. And when I get interview requests, or I get Facebook messages, or even intrusive Twitter hacks or Twitter trolling, they do mention Bangladesh, and I'm very, very happy about it.
My point is that it is not about name dropping. I'm not talking about, but I'm talking about the cultural paradigms,
right,
which has been. I mean, you may not have to name all the names,
right,
in the contemporary times. We're doing work, but I'm saying that maybe have reflections of the
right
contemporary state of Bengali culture in Kolkata,
right,
in Bengal, or outside Bengal. I'm trying to reflection on that are we the great cultural areas we went through, the moments we went through, but are we carrying that legacy to that extent? You know, that was my question.
Well,
it's not about naming all the names we're doing right now. It's not about contemporary.
Oh, good, I provoked him. Wonderful.
Yeah,
you
yeah
thought he's going to provoke me?
Yeah,
no.
It is all about counter provocation. So now, let's not get into that, but that was my intent.
I agree with you. Suman's absolutely right. In fact, I sort of owned up to this sort of lack in a way, or a lack is probably the correct way of saying it. But maybe it's because of my burden I carry, or my skill, or my background as a journalist, where I've had backgrounds in sort of political history, or political economy, or conflicts, or economics, so on and so forth. I tend to sometimes tell stories in the way that I know best. So I think I have addressed certain aspects of when names are taken or situations are discussed in the political arena or socio-political arena, developments in West Bengal or Bangladesh or elsewhere. I think they are reflected. But I haven't told it always through the prism of culture. I've told it through the prism also of conflicts or of politics, or of socioeconomic development,
yes,
or of literary over, or of could be a people's movement, or could be an outrage, or must. I have a chapter called Mastanocracy. I mean, through the eyes of mastans that we've had since the 1960s onwards, and it hasn't stopped. We are a mastanocracy, not a democracy. I firmly believe that. So I think my telling has maybe been sort of biased in a way, that I've worn these prisms, I've seen it through these prisms, rather than, say, a purely cultural prism, you know? So yes, I fully admit to this, that the book lacks a telling always through the cultural prism. I have tried to talk about culture as it is, but Suman, you're absolutely right. I think that were I to rework the book, or as you suggested, write a sequel, God forbid, it'll take me a while, that I might try to do it better, or perhaps offer it a more roundedness than I might have in this telling.
But I would really appreciate, I think you mentioned that, but I want to kind of reinforce that point, that when we talk about different prisms to tell history, not only about the cultural prism, but culture contains all the socio-cultural paradoxes, the politics, the subliminal, you know, movement of, you know, socio-political awareness, which is omnipresent in this book very strongly, which I found lacking in other perspectives of history, that the continuous awareness of the socio-political milieu and that domain which makes you think that you are not a casual reader, you are a casual writer, and you cannot read this book without some sense of, what I would say, that some understanding of the socio-cultural movements. And that writer provokes you all the time, or you know, incites you, or gives you that insight of the thing that it is not only a cultural movement we're talking about, but there's always a socio-political movement which is subliminal in any work we do. And that's why he's writing about the Deshbhakt, or about, when you're talking about the Maoists, the Naxalite movement, it comes out so brilliantly in this book, you know, in terms of everything. And that's what I really appreciate, that your continuous, you know, pushing the writer, the reader, to that point, that you have to be aware of these political situations. You cannot be oblivious about that, you know, because we are, as a common, in the contemporary readers, are always, you know, so-called positions called apolitical or non-political. Is, I think that these books gives you that, you know, always, you know, pushes you towards that you cannot read history from leniently. You cannot read culture from just a cultural point of view, that I am appreciating art, literature, cinema, without any background, within a cultural evolution, without an understanding where we came from and what is our political evolution also at the same time. So I think that makes this book very special for me. So I think we've come to an end to our discussion, and I will open up the session for the people who are here, who will be getting bored, maybe now at the point of getting bored about our discussions, should ask questions if they, whatever they think from this discussion, or generally about,
I have got two small questions, one for you and one for Suman. First of all, I thank you for making me conscious of the word non-Bengali, because I never thought it is arrogant. But I wonder what would an American call a non-American person. I don't know much. I have not thought about it. Thank you very much. But I'll think about it. Thank you.
Americans have a worse term. They call them aliens.
How many of them? Arakta kotha leta amar mone holo je I was so lacking, but could have been made more clear. That is this. You have described the geographical space, yes. But what do you mean by Bengali? Bengali speaking? If that be so, then a good number of our children will be non-Bengali, because they don't speak Bangla. They speak in English. And when I say that by some book is coming, Bangla! You see, the young children, I am not criticizing them, because time is changing, and we must move with the time, and we must accept the timely changes. But what I'm asking you is, what, who are Bengalis? For example, I'm Marwari woman, married to a Bengali man. Will she be Bengali? A Bengali man married to a Marwari woman, who will be Bengali?
Well, definitely the Marwari will be the Bengali, because you know, there is no question about it.
We don't accept that. Good point, again and again. First of all, in refer to the culture, which I could really wanted to elaborate, but there is no time. But I want to ask you one. You are now in Bombay. Tell me what you said again and again, the new Bengali movement. What do you, staying in Bengali, understand? That is one. If you explain that,
I'll
be very happy.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. See, the Bengali can also be polite. The men, from time to time, as well. Bhalo chale. So, well, ma'am, thank you for your question. I think I was saved by a hyphen. Yeah, ethno-linguistic. That was my escape. Ethno-linguistic. There is such a phrase called ethno-linguistic. So, and that saved me. The hyphen saved me to a great, great extent, because I could look at the ethnicity factor as a people. I could look at the linguistic factor as a people. So, and I think I tried to address the book from the ethno-linguistic perspective, and that. In its sort of stream of consciousness or subconsciousness.
Suman did not elaborate, but he hinted about the cultural aspect. But okay, we'll leave that.
No, but
you tell me
Bengali. Now what I tried to make. Now what I tried. But every period has some point of departure, movements of new transcendence. It can feel good, it can feel bad, but
what
it is forward moving. So what I'm saying, at one point of time, suppose me as an artist, as I'm growing up, we are born in late 60s, and then we are going through 80s and 90s, and 2000 we are doing our cinema and theater, whatever I'm doing. So we are talking to a time which is completely changed from from 70s to 2000. If you see, from 70s to 80s to 90s to 2000, there's a sea change, what we talk about, like inter social cultural politics, the perception of the language, as you said, that Bengalis are not speaking Bengali. So this is a new statement. So this is a new Bengali culture which is coming up. You yourself stated that position.
But
right?
Some other time, when you have more time, you explain to me the features.
This is one of the features. This is indicating my son, or your daughters or your granddaughters or son, they're reading certain stuff. They are accustomed to certain kind of television programs. They're listening to new kind of technology. So this defines a new generation.
That's the point.
New technology. We are watching films on the iPhone.
Yes.
And that is the next culture which is coming up.
Yes,
so
yes.
That is defining
yes.
a new cultural movement. So we are adapting as an artist to this new cultural movements. We cannot negate them. No, we only doing 70mm celluloid films. No. We are doing cellular film, we are doing shooting on iPhone, because we are adapting to the new culture. We are making films thinking that it will be seen on an iPhone.
But how is the new Bengali
screen.
Movement?
No, because this is part of Bengali also. Because Bengal had its own socio-cultural
worldwide movement.
But as we define it, we are trying to locate one point where we are Bengalis and we have our history in a different way. Which got mixed up in different ways. That was a very, rudimentary definition.
Yeah.
It's a big question.
I know.
I think partly it is our fault. We haven't addressed these issues as forcefully as we could have. We've addressed them in our own language, in Bangla. And this is not unknown to the Bengali. It's been known to the Bengali from the time the first partition happened, and a lot of our writing and a lot of our political and social movements began with that sense of partition and coming together, and then 46 was a trauma, even in Purva Bangalore, even in East Bengal, and later in Pakistan, East Pakistan. So I think amongst ourselves, it's not an unknown quantum, but it has not transcended the language barrier or the ethno-linguistic barrier, if you will, in a way that the train to Pakistan or the tellings of history that have been attempted by people from, say, the Punjab, or the both Punjabs, or people from the Pakistani Punjab who sort of moved into the Indian Punjab or Delhi or Calcutta. So there hasn't been I don't think we've had a stream of telling or narration in English. You've had stray instances like Tamas, which is sort of transcended the language barrier because, you know, it got translated into English. It was made into a TV, a very, very well-regarded TV serial. So it had great exposure. But I think that was the odd one. There's been also a lot of telling in English directly, which somehow hasn't been part of the Bengali situation. And now, certain histories are being told, say, in Bangladesh, about the birth of Bangladesh in English.
As with Dr. Ashish Mogi's research, for example.
Yes.
Right? So that did deal with the Bengali.
Definitely did. But again, it was not. See, you've always had people individually who have done it.
Right.
All right. But the gentleman is absolutely
now
right. When you say partition, they'll say, oh, Lahore. Or they'll say Rawalpindi.
Right.
Or they'll say Sindh. Or, you know,
right.
They will say Jalandhar, they say Amritsar,
yeah.
or even UP, or even Bihar, or even Bengal. I mean, the sort of moving west, but again, the migration, because partition had migratory responses
yeah.
both
yeah.
ways.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people from, say, Howrah,
yeah.
or Birbhum, or Purulia, or Bapura, who were Muslim, who went to what is present-day Bangladesh.
Yeah.
Many, many more Hindus came over from present-day
yeah.
Bangladesh to India. So that is part of our telling, but not necessarily part of the Indian telling. There is a great difference. So Ashish Babu has done a fine job, and he's not the only one. So I thought it was very important for me to address that, because it's not just to bring it to a sort of an English consciousness, or a consciousness in English, but also acknowledge the fact that it still drives us, in fact, more deeply than it does people in the West. I believe in the Western partition, people have transcended the partition to a great extent, which we have not.
Spoken about it, the other side.
Possibly, that's a wonderful way of saying it, because they probably have rationalized it more. But even we, who have written about it so much in Bangla, are still living in many ways with a partition in our minds and hearts. Or our hearts may be whole, but our minds are partitioned. Or our dreams may be whole, but our reality is partitioned. So I don't think we still deal with it, and thank God we do. But you're right, sir. I mean, I couldn't agree more, which I thought was very, very important for me to address our partition, the forgotten partition, as far as India is concerned, or as far as the world is concerned. So thank you for asking.
I thank you all for your presence here. And before you all take a copy of your book, may I request Mrs. Priyanshi Patel, the founder of the Ahmedabad Book Club, to please come up and present a token of appreciation to the author in the conversations of the evening.